my baby beside me at the wheel. I stole a kiss at the turn of a mile, my curiosity running wild. Cruising and playing the radio with no particular place to go.
In the 1940s, the way people travelled around the country was very different from today. Not many people had a car. Roads hadn't changed very much since the turn of the century. Motorways were unheard of. Most people used the train for long journeys, and the trains themselves were very different from how they are today. Most trains were pulled by steam engines, not diesel or electric, and there were many more trains than today. The country was a patchwork of main lines and branch lines. Looking back, people have a sort of fondness for steam engines. Ron Kennedy was lucky enough to do the job that some schoolboys dreamt about. He drove a steam express train. He served his apprenticeship as an engine cleaner, then he graduated to a fireman, and he eventually drove one of the most famous engines in Britain.
Well, this is the Flying Scotsman. I first met this engine in 1947 as an engine cleaner, and we used to clean these, so you can see how sparkly it is now, and that's how they used to be every day when they went out on a job. The skills that you needed is to understand the engine, to get to know it and work with it, and also we always used to say on the railway, they didn't pay you for driving it, they paid you for taking it where you knew it was going and how to stop it. But you needed a good fireman to produce the steam, because it was a fireman that gave you the power of the steam. And of course, it was about conserving energy as well. A steam engine is just like a big kettle. You light the fire up inside the firebox, creates the steam in the boiler. It goes to the top of the engine, into the valves, and when the driver opens the valve, the steam is transferred from the top, comes straight away down to the pistons, which moves these rods, which turns the wheels. And that's the principle of a steam engine. On one of these types of engines in the old days, on a 5-hour trip to Newcastle, you could shovel up to 8 to 10 tonne of coal, and you'd use 55,000 gallons of water.
Ron witnessed one of the great revolutions on the railways, the end of steam engines and the introduction of diesel and then electric trains to replace them.
I was driving these engines when I became a driver in 1958, and so till 1963 I was driving steam engines, and I was pleased to see the diesels coming along. I'm a great believer in an efficient railway system, and because these standing still cost a lot of money, because they still use coal and water standing still, not working. But with a diesel, you can shut a diesel off. Then we went from the diesels into electrification, which are the most powerful things that you can do. They travel the countryside 125 mile an hour, and when you think about that, that's pretty fast, pretty fast.
Not everyone agreed with Ron Kennedy's view. The old steam engines were scrapped and went to what people call graveyards. They were a sad sight. But the end of steam engines wasn't the only great change that happened on Britain's railways after the war. In 1948, the four big private companies that ran the railways were nationalised, bought by the government from private companies. This is what the network of railways looked like in one part of the United Kingdom, Northern Ireland, in 1948. Gradually, in the 1950s and 60s, lots of these little lines, branch lines they were called, disappeared. One of the lines that disappeared in 1957 was a little branch line that ran from Enniskillen in Northern Ireland to Sligo in the Irish Republic. When you look at the film that was shot on the last days of the line, you can get an idea of what people thought about the loss of their railway.
I spent it in good company.
The last day, the 30th September 1957, I remember it quite well. That journey was a very sad journey.
People gathered here and a lot of them practically in tears. We had balloons and stickers and music going, an accordion going, and them singing a song, a last farewell to the SL and NCR.
I can't recall.
It had a terrible impact on the whole area. The roads, we had bad road structures at the time.
A lot of people that time, you see, there was only 1957, there was very few cars really. There had no transport really in a lot of cases.
The local characters that worked here on the railway for so long, they also were so sad, losing a job and what have you.
But since it fell into my lot, that I should rise and you should not.
So on the train, it was like a happy home. You could move about through the corridors and have a chat with everybody. The mothers and the fathers would go away with their family when they would be going off, and it was sad. And the train was most valuable.
What happened in Northern Ireland happened all over the country. In 1948, the United Kingdom had 32,000 kilometres of track. By 1970, it was down to about half that. But it wasn't only the railways that went through change after 1945. Travel around towns and cities changed too. These are pictures of London in the 1950s. When you look at them, what strikes you? Well, there weren't many cars in the cities then, but there were trams. Most big cities in Britain had trams. They ran on rails bedded in the roads and were powered by electricity from overhead cables. A ride on a tram was quite an experience.
We had passengers who travelled for the pleasure of travelling on the top of a tram, the front of the top of a tram.
David Proffitt had always wanted to work on the trams.
It was my ambition as a child to be a tram conductor, because I'd, as a child, had always loved trams. There was something special about them, the shape of them. They were rattly, they were noisy, they shook, they swayed. But there was something, again, something special about the sway and the rattle.
Oh, Glasgow trams, they really were something. I mean, everybody had a great deal of affection for the Glasgow trams. It was a tremendous system they had in the city. I think just about everybody travelled the trams. Jumped on a tram and you're away to another part of the city, and everybody did that. They were very cheap and very popular.
The sun is out, the sky is blue. There's not a cloud to spoil the view, but it's raining, raining in my heart.
As the 60s approached, the trams that were starting to lose money, they were expensive to run. Buses and trolley buses were going to be the thing of the future. So bit by bit, they phased the trams out.
Raining in my heart.
We were told that the trams would cease operation on, in our case, it was the 6th of April, 1952. I worked on the very last day of the trams. It was with a sense of almost desolation that we handed over to another crew late afternoon. The majority of the trams were taken to a breaker's yard in South London.
Oh, misery.
There'd be 60, 70, 80 trams, all looking desolate. I think they knew.
I tell my blues.
Ultimately, when everything useful had been taken off the trams, they were literally left as skeletons. They were pushed over by bulldozers and burned. One could look at the trams and imagining the trams feeling sad themselves. I know that's a foolish thing to say, because obviously they had no heart, but we felt they had a heart.
People would love to have the trams back. They see the trams now as an environmentally friendly way of travelling because there's no pollution, very little noise, and they were very comfortable.
But as trains and trams vanished in the 1950s, it was the motor car that took over. In 1945, fewer than 1 in 10 adults owned a car. By 1970, 1 in 2 did. That was the scale of the change.
Thank you for the days. Those endless days, those sacred days you gave me.
Like so many families, we couldn't afford a car of our own, but I remember that we had an uncle, I always thought he was the rich uncle, who had a very smart MG that used to come and park outside here, and we would go for rides in it sometimes.
And though you're gone, you're with me every single day, believe me. Days I'll remember all my life. Days.
But in those days, you know, teenagers and young adults, if they couldn't afford a car, they'd invariably go for a scooter, like a Lambretta. Then they'd move up perhaps into a bubble car, which was really just like an aircraft cockpit with the, you know, three wheels.
I know people used to laugh at them, but in fact they were very, very, very good to drive. Very simple, economical. You could go for hundreds of miles on the petrol. Easy to maintain. It was as simple as that.
Those endless days, those sacred days you gave me. I'm thinking of the days. I won't forget a single day, believe me.
Looking at somebody else's was as close as most working class people got to a car in the 1950s. But if you had money, it was different. Chris Elliott's parents did.
But then I knew that very soon you'd leave me. But it's all right. Now I'm not frightened.
Well, my mother used to use the car most of the time. I think that was typical of those days, is the husband would go off to work. The wives would take the husbands to the station in the morning, maybe take the kids to school, drive around during the day, do the shopping or whatever they were doing in the afternoon, evening, go and collect the husbands from the station again. So they were the main users of the cars in a lot of respects. He had a good job with Esso, always liked Jags, so he bought 2 Jags. It was about between £300 and £400, this particular first one, the white one. I think that's where my interest in cars came from.
I wanted a Mini because it was the car of the day, it was the icon. It was all the cars that the boys drove. You could tune them up, you could put stickers on them, you could put the extra lights on. It was just the thing that you wanted in those days. It was smaller, it was a 2-door car. Had smaller wheels, little 10-inch wheels on there. Very little bonnet in the front. Just a compact motor, you could get it into a parking space very easily. I used the Mini to get to work during the week. But at weekends, that was different. You go to the pub on a Friday night, meet your mates, go into town on a Saturday. It was just great, full of people. Off you go, enjoy yourself. That's what life was about.
New cars were expensive, certainly too much for Ken Hand. He could afford only a used car. And as you'll hear, he had to share the cost and the car with his brother.
Well, in 1963, we bought this Morris Minor. But I bought, when I say we, I meant myself and my brother, and we ran it between us, you know, because he had a motorbike, and then he used to leave his motorbike here when he wanted to use a car, because he weren't married then. If he went out courting or anything, he used to take the car, because I could use his motorbike while he was out in the car, or vice versa. It was quite sort of modern in those days, you know. I mean, it was quite a nice shape, and it was also nice to drive, you know. Of course, there weren't any motorways or anything in those days, you know. Well, we used to use it for holidays, mostly, and going shopping, and just general family use, really, you know. Then eventually I bought his half off of him and owned the whole car sort of thing, you know.
As the number of cars grew, so the road system became crowded and the first motorway was built. The M1 was opened in 1959. And it was something of a tourist attraction in the early days.
Right, well, as you can hear, this is the M1. And I wanted to preserve it on film. Ooh, back in 1959. And I brought my children up here and filmed the event. And it was quite memorable. Of course, in those days, it was different. It was a two-lane wide road, either side. Now, as you can see, it's a three-lane. It was very quiet. I mean, there used to be quite long delays in between the cars passing. But it rapidly became, you know, as it is today.
Soon they had the idea of not only linking cities with motorways, but building them right through urban areas. Glasgow was typical. Great areas of the city centre were demolished to make way for the new roads.
Glasgow was getting really congested around about the 50s, and they knew they had to do something. So the plan was to build the Kingston Bridge, which was going to be part of the ring road system through the city. So they did the bridge first, then they built the motorway. But when they built the motorway connecting to either ends of the bridge, this meant driving the M8 right through the heart of the city. You know, to demolish large areas of the town. It was as if a bomb hit Glasgow at that time. It was just torn apart. They spoiled the appearance of a lot of the area because of this great sort of gouge they carved right through the city because the motorway's down low. Eventually, we got a half ring road because they built half of it, but they never had the funds to complete the complete circle.
So the years since the war have seen huge changes in transport and travel on the railways and the roads. Too many changes for a lot of people. And now some towns and cities are going back to trams and trains. But while these changes were taking place all around us, there are also massive changes going on above our heads.
8 miles high, and when you touch down, you'll find that it's stranger than known. Signs in the street that say where you're going are somewhere just being their own. Small places unknown.